Okay. What we will end up today is something like this. Okay, this is the first line. Say we will have a block presentation of the processor. Okay, the first block is the instruction memory that you can read your program from here, and then you have the register in the RISC V. There are 32 register here, and then you have one arithmetic logic unit which can perform arithmetic, add, subtract, and then comparison logic function and or not, and branch function, right? And the last block is your RAM, okay, the main memory. You can get the data from the memory, right, into register. You can see this line here, and you can write from register output to the memory. You can see this line here, okay, so you can get through and from the memory. And to be able to control the sequence of instruction, you have one block here called program counter that address the instruction memory, which instruction to be executed. Okay. And to advance the program counter, we have this adder, and the very easy is the next instruction is further 4 byte further. This is address program counter. The instruction is 32 bit for RISC V, and the data is 64 bit. Okay, so this processor address the memory using byte. So one word is 32 bits, so there are 4 bytes in one word. And for the data, one data is 64 bits, so it's a double word. Okay, double word 64, the word is 32, the byte is 8 bit. Okay, the last block is another adder. We just talk about adder, right? So we now familiar with the adder circuit. Have to do with branching. Okay, so when you say branch if equal, then you do a kind of relative to this program counter. It's a part of where to jump to come from instruction memory. Okay, like jump branch is not equal to the exit, and maybe the exit is 100 bytes further, therefore we add that small number which come from instruction memory here, and then use that to set the program counter to execute next instruction, right? So I think we are not going into detail inside the block, just how this block behave according to some instruction. So when we put in full decoration, which we talk about the blue part next week, it become like this. Okay, so we put in just how to control ALU operation. Okay, how to control read and write memory, how to control write of register, right? How to control setting the program counter. Okay. In order to do that, let me remind you of the actual instruction. Okay, remember this is slide number 5. So if you are confusing, then you can come back. We are talking about first of all, I think, to do some kind of arithmetic. So that maybe the first two instruction, add, right, have a 3 argument, right, or the register number. Okay, all right. So I think we begin with this kind of operation first, and then we have to do with the next is how to get to and from the memory. We are not showing the actual sequence of full set of instructions, just some instruction to be representative. Okay, so we understand how this data part, because the whole thing, the black line is called data part, the blue line is called control unit. Okay. The next instruction we have to understand, the first is to operate on register, which is the first block. Okay. Right. Actually, first block, we have to be able to read the instruction and then to perform operation, and then you can get the data from the memory. So that's three part. Okay. This is just the reminder of what the instruction look like, because it is to do with the actual data part. So we have to know the encoding of the instruction. Okay, we don't have to actually know the binary number, but just say that it has the what kind of information stored in one instruction. Okay, like for example, for the add, we need the number of register. Okay. Right, the source, two source register, one destination register, and that's all. Right, for the format immediate, we have some constant. Right, so we have some small number that can, and some format S we have a bit quite similar, but a bit more complicated because the immediate value is actually separate into two places. All of this complication is unnecessary. Are the consequence of designing the instruction. Okay, it's going to have 32 bit, so we have to use all the bit as efficient as possible. And I have to talk about addressing mode a little bit more, because all the behavior of the circuit have to do with a lot of addressing mode. First is the immediate addressing. Therefore, the instruction use some blue part of this is instruction, this is not data. Okay, this some part of the instruction, and use that value to do the operation, like add immediate, maybe add the register 2 with the value 20. So the value 20 will be embedded in the instruction here. Okay, second is register addressing, that is most fundamental. You can add to the value of two registers together and store in the third register. Okay, so it just have to know the number of register, right? Data part itself is 64 bit. Okay, instruction is 32 bit. The third addressing mode is a bit address, where we can use part of small number in the instruction plus the value of register, okay, to address the memory. Our memory can be addressed as a byte, okay, half word, okay, half word is 32, half word is 16 bit, half word will be used. Okay, so we can address 1, 2, 3, 4 kind of addressing, okay, at the byte, at the half word, at the word 32 bit, at the double word at the 64 bit. The last is branching it to do with a some value in the instruction plus value of program counter. Okay, and we address at the word. Right, I better use my mouse. Okay, this slide show you the timing of synchronous logic. So we have first of all clock cycle, and what I want to explain is what happened when, right? So the chain of the state, or the what do you call it? The chain of the value in all the register will happen on this, the beginning of this cycle, boom, 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 boom. And the next step will chain here. Okay, so one complete clock is from 0 to 1, and one come back to 0 and 0 to 1. Okay, so this complete clock. So the state change on the beginning of the clock and then all the value propagate. So the digital change, the value electrical signal go to the combination like a full adder, and then within this one clock, the output of the full adder is valid. Okay, and then we can use that for to do the next instruction. So let's start with the reading instruction from the memory. We have the instruction memory. This is unusual, okay? Actually, instruction memory also reside in the RAM, in the main memory. But for this presentation, we divide it into two parts. We use program counter to address the instruction memory. Therefore, instruction come out. And we control, once we read the instruction out, for the next instruction, we increment the program counter by 4 register operation. So you read the value from 2 register, perform the operation on arithmetic logic unit, and then write the value back to the register. So let's see the detail of the block of register. Register for read 5 have a 32 register, and the format of instruction, I put it here for to remind you that we have the number of register here, okay? 3 register, okay, and we have the operational code. Say this is an instruction add. Operation code have 2 part. One is opcode 0110011, okay, and then the second part of opcode is function 7, which is different between add and subtract, and also function 3, which is all. It is, you don't have to worry about why so and so. Okay, it's all the small detail in trying to specify which instruction and what it does in 32 bit. Okay, addressing the register have to use 5 bit for each register. So we have register number 1, 5 bit. Register number 2, 5 bit. Okay. And destination register also 5 bit. So this is the register input. And we have one signal, okay, the data. Remember that the data is 64 bits, so it's a lot. And with reader, we can always read 2. Once we put the number here, the value will be available on the 2 port. And then we can read 2 registers out at once, each of them 64 bit. Okay. And the data go to arithmetic logic unit. So we can specify whether we want to add to subtract, do something else, a comparison and other thing. Okay, so we read instruction. We know how the functional block related to register operation. Data memory, actually RAM. Okay, so we have address. This machine have 64 bit address, okay? So there's nothing to mention about it. And then the value to write into the data memory, 64 bit address is very big, almost impossible to buy the RAM. Okay, why not just 32 bit? Why have to be 64? First of all, we have the data part, the arithmetic logic unit, which can perform 64 arithmetic, right? Therefore, when we calculate the address, it's easier just to calculate 64 bit. Okay, we can be more realistic, say 32 bit is enough. However, in your notebook, you probably have more than 4 gigabyte of memory, right? 4 gigabyte of memory is addressing by 32 bit address. So even the computer that you use now to listen to the lecture has more than 32 bit. And because everything calculation is 64 bit, therefore the value that we embedded in instruction, like the immediate value, that sort of thing, okay, have to be expanded to become 64 bit. this kind of expansion is all to do with the extension of sine extension. So in terms of actual circuit, it's very simple. It's almost wiring, nothing important. And the control is to read from the memory or to write the memory, because we have two control signals. The last group of instruction is branching. That we compare to register, and then we do the addressing of PC relative. Okay, so this kind of address. Let's see the actual branching. Remember that we compare the value from two registers. So the first block that we have to use to execute this instruction is this register, and then we read two register, right? And which register to be used come from instruction, which come from instruction memory here, okay? So we have some instruction, and the register is specified, right? Each of them are 5-bit here, okay? And then we read two register to and specify the arithmetic operation or logic operation to compare, for comparison. And then we know, okay, if it say branch is equal, right, then we say, okay, we have some output, say if it equal or not equal, all right? And because the jump or not jump depend on relative to program counter, so we have one of the address come from program counter, and the other one, which one, come from the offset where you want to jump to. Okay, so it's PC relative. So in the previous example, is number 100, right? You see the first line bar branch is equal to the 100. So it's that kind of one, 100, number 100. You have to come from instruction. Okay, it changed to the 64 because our adder is 64-bit. Address is 64-bit, okay, which is quite enormous. Now, why there is one chip left here? Chip left by one means multiply by two, right? Double the address. I will not explain too much here because you cannot just ignore it. Say, okay, it's some value from the instruction add to program counter and then use that as the branch address. If it jump, it jump to here. If it not jump, it jump to the next instruction, okay? This can be fully explained in the page 115, okay? You cannot jump into the middle instruction, right? So your instruction have to be on the word, right? On the 4 byte. You cannot jump into the 2 byte in the middle. Read 5 when it start the development. It also want to have for a very small machine. So it want to have a 16-bit instruction. Yeah. So they want half word instruction. But to be able to execute load and store instruction. Okay, so what it does, of course, when you want to load, you have to specify which part of memory you want. Okay, so you have to be able to do the address. When you want to read it, okay, you give the address. The address is come from some base addressing. Remember base addressing? There's some small part have to be added to the base register value to address the location of memory. Okay, so it's here. So that small number in the instruction come here, right, and feed to ALU, and we use arithmetic logic unit to compute the effective address, okay, to address the RAM, the memory. Okay, and output of the data go back to write into register here. Okay, that's how we load. How we store? we use the register, right, to add the data, and also we compute the effective value. It's similar. Now we control the memory to write much easier. Okay. We compose everything together, and the final group of instruction for this CPU to perform is a branch instruction. We have to compute the PC relative address. So part of it already explained. So we have this one, okay, to compute the target or branching address. Maybe it just the next address. Okay, you can say, okay, let's use the next address. So this is a multiplexer. Multiplexer is some kind of switch. You can choose, there's two input, one output. Okay, you can choose one of the input to go out. Okay, if I choose the upper one, I just use the next instruction, right? So it go back to program counter. The next instruction is this program counter plus four, because it's by addressing. Okay, so it go boom, next instruction here, right? If not, if I want to jump, I have to jump to PC relative. So I use the value of the program counter here, adding to the some small number from the instruction, which is expansion into 64 bit, and multiply by two. Okay, and then add here. This is more or less historical. It's a do something PC relative, and then if it's jump, then we control to use this address rather than the upper address, which is next instruction. It is jump instruction, so it go back to program counter. I think that's finalized all the design of CPU, okay, which is very modern, very simple, okay.